أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. All praise is due to Allah. Peace and blessings of Allah be upon our beloved, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and those who follow him rightly and correctly till the day of resurrection. Dear respected listeners, I would like first and foremost to salute you all with the salutation of peace, with the salutation of the people of paradise. تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As announced, the talk of today, as many of you are aware, the talk of today will be about Al-Hajj, because we are approaching this great season, the season of Al-Hajj, and I know some of you are going to perform Al-Hajj this year, and I know also some of you who haven't been to Al-Hajj, who haven't been even to Mecca Al-Mukarrama, and they're intending one day to perform this pillar of Islam, this obligation, Al-Hajj, which is translated roughly as pilgrimage. And hence the talk of today will be about Al-Hajj, insha'Allah ta'ala. The importance of today's topic stems from the fact that Al-Hajj is one of the great pillars of Islam. As you know, Islam has been built upon how many pillars? Upon five pillars, as was narrated authentically and correctly on the authority of Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, who said, I heard the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, say, Bunya al-Islamu ala khams. This is a very famous prophetic statement. Bunya al-Islamu ala khams. Islam has been built upon five pillars. Shahadatu an la ilaha illallah. As you know, the testimony that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his messenger. This is the first pillar. وَإِقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ, the establishment of prayer. وَإِتَاءُ الزَّكَاةِ, giving الزَّكَاةِ, the obligatory charity. وَصَوْمُ رَمَضَانِ, fasting the month of Ramadan. وَحَجُّ الْبَيْتِ لِمَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, and performing الحج, pilgrimage to Mecca al-Mukarrama for those who are capable to do so, to perform الحج. So Al-Hajj is one of the pillars of Islam. Once Iman is not complete without performing Al-Hajj. Once Iman is incomplete without going and performing Al-Hajj, if he is or she is able to perform Al-Hajj. So Al-Hajj, as I said, is indispensable part of the religion of Islam for those who are able to do so. And this is clearly stated in the glorious Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made Al-Hajj an obligation upon every single Muslim by the saying of His Almighty, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. It is the duty of people towards Allah to take the journey to Mecca to perform Al-Hajj. وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. It is the duty of people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to perform Al-Hajj for those who are able to do so. So the verse is crystal clear that Al-Hajj is an obligation. And what confirms this notion is the conclusion of this verse, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ومن كفر فإن الله غني عن العالمين. Here Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a type of kufr, because al-kufr is of two types. Major kufr, it is what we call shirk, which takes one out of the fold of Islam. This is the major kufr. And there is another type of kufr, which is the minor kufr. The minor kufr does not take one out of the fold of Islam. And the minor kufr is what is intended, is what is meant here in this verse. وَمَنْ كَفَرَ, and who disbelieves by leaving, who commits kufr by leaving al-haq, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. Then know Allah is independent of any human being, of any being in this world. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. So what is meant here is the minor kufr. If one doesn't perform al-haq and he is able to do so, then he committed a minor form of kufr, that is kufr ni'ma. We call it in Arabic kufr al-ni'ma. So there are two types of kufr. This is very important to know. This is very important to understand, because when you recite verses in the Holy Quran and many prophetic traditions, you find the word kufr attributed for Muslims who leave certain acts, who leave minor acts, who doesn't leave the major acts, or who doesn't, I mean, they are leaving minor acts and they believe in their obligation. But the word kufr was attributed to them. It is not meant by this word of kufr they are out of the fold of Islam. Rather, they are still Muslims. They are still our brothers, our sisters. However, they are sinful by leaving this type of kufr. I put a great emphasis on this issue because many people might quote some verses from here and there and accuse their fellow Muslims, brothers or sisters, of being kuffar, of being kafir. And by extension, they deem that their blood is lawful. And this is a form of fanaticism. This is a form of extremism. So one should be careful not to fall in this trap. So the kufr in the Holy Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is of two types. Kufr shirk, if one denies one of the pillars of Islam, if one denies one of the pillars of Iman, yes, he is committing in this case a major kufr. He isn't Muslim anymore. If he denies the obligation of prayer, of charity, for example, of the even the Hajj, if he denies the obligation of Hajj, he denies that al-Hajj is one of the pillars of Islam. In this case, yes, he is kafir, kufr shirk, meaning he is out of the religion of Islam. But if he simply leaves al-Hajj out of laziness, we cannot say that he is kafir. If he is leaving the prayer, even the prayer, if he is abandoning the prayer from time, he sometimes prays, sometimes leaves, we cannot say he is mushrik. He is disbeliever entirely. So one should be careful unless he denies the obligation of al-Hajj, or unless he denies any of the pillars of Iman. He denies the prophethood of Muhammad. He denies, for example, the Day of Judgment, the Hellfire, the Paradise, the prophethood of the previous messengers mentioned in the Holy Quran. Yes, in this case, he isn't Muslim anymore. So this is an important issue. I thought it is very essential, it is very crucial to put it crystal clear before you. So describing the one who leaves al-Hajj as kafir shows you how important al-Hajj is, how significant al-Hajj is. So much so, the one who leaves al-Hajj has committed a form of kufr, even if it is a minor form of kufr. And the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in another verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, the second chapter of the Holy Quran, also commands us to perform al-Hajj and al-umrah even, wa atimmu al-hajja wal umrata lillah, and complete al-hajj and al-umrah lillah, for the sake of pleasing Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are plenty narrations in the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in which he commanded his companions, and by extension, it is a commandment for us to perform al-hajj, to go for al-hajj, to fulfill this great duty, this great obligation upon us. The Prophet, peace be upon him, in a narration says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْحَجَّ فَحُجُّمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written upon you al-hajj, pilgrimage to Mecca, then fahujjum, then perform al-hajj. And the Prophet, there are plenty of narrations of that which was narrated in the Sahih collection of Imam al-Rabi', the sound hadith collection of Imam al-Rabi', from the authority of Al-Aqra' ibn Habis, that the Prophet, peace be upon him, once prayed, led people in the noon prayer, dhuhr prayer, and he asked them, سَلُونِي عَمَّا شِئْتُمْ, ask me whatever you wish, وَلَا يَسْأَلْنِي أَحَدٌ مِّنْكُمْ عَنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا أَخْبَرْتُهُ بِهِ, and nobody of you asks me about an issue unless I'll give him an answer about this issue, about that issue. Then Al-Aqra' ibn Habis, one of the Prophet's companion, asked the Prophet, saying that Al-Hajj wajibun alayna fi kulli aam, inna Allah kataba alayna Al-Hajj, afahuwa wajibun alayna fi kulli aam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Aqra' ibn Habis, saying, has written Al-Hajj upon us. Is it obligatory for us every single year? The Prophet, peace be upon him, became angry, and he said to him, if I said yes, then it would be obligatory. If I said yes, it would be obligatory. And if it is obligatory every single year, you wouldn't be able to do so. Al-Hajj wajibun fi kulli aamin marra. Al-Hajj is only obligatory once per lifetime. So it is not obligatory every single year. It is only obligatory once per lifetime. Once one has done al-hajj, he isn't required to redo it again in any year, as long as he performed it correctly, as long as he performed it without any shortcoming. Hence, it is very important to know the pillars of al-hajj. It is very important to know the obligations of al-hajj, the restrictions of al-hajj, or the restriction of al-ihram. Mahdurat al-ihram, we call it in Arabic. It is very important, because committing some of these mahdurat restrictions might result in one's hajj being null and void. And leaving, on another hand, one of the pillars of al-hajj might also result in one's hajj being null and void. Hence, it is very important to acquire a sound knowledge regarding al-hajj. Hence, we are talking this morning about preparatory acts about al-hajj. I wouldn't claim that we are going to cover the entire chapter of al-hajj, but at least to talk in this session, in this short session, about preparatory acts about al-hajj. And there are a number of days before al-hajj, insha'Allah ta'ala. One could catch up what we miss in this session. So al-hajj, as I said, one of the obligations of Islam, and it is the fifth pillar of Islam. It is the fifth pillar of Islam, as we quoted earlier the narration of Ibn Umar, may Allah have mercy on him. And it is very important to bear in mind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he ordained al-hajj, when he asked us to perform al-hajj, he doesn't want from us to perform just only physical acts. Yes, the physical actions, the physical rituals in al-hajj are essential, are indispensable parts of performing al-hajj, but there is also a spiritual message behind al-hajj. There is also a spiritual message behind al-hajj. So al-hajj, it is not just a physical journey from one land to another land. It is beside that also a spiritual journey from one state in one's life to another state, maybe from a state of disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to a state of being obedient to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So al-hajj has to be a turning point in one's life. And as a matter of fact, we notice every year that many people, when they come back from al-hajj, they come back in a better state. In a better state, they leave, for example, certain things that they were accustomed to before going to al-hajj. Some of them would smoke before al-hajj. Some of them would commit major sins before al-hajj. But when they come from this spiritual journey, this emotional journey, they would abandon all these sins, all of these major sins. That is when al-hajj is, that is when one performs al-hajj correctly, gives one's the result. I mean, when one performs al-hajj correctly, perfectly, as was ordained and enshrined in the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, there only al-hajj gives you its fruits. There only al-hajj gives you its fruits. So it is worth bearing in mind that al-hajj, it is not only a physical journey, it is a spiritual journey, it is emotional journey, it is a journey of life. It is a journey of life. So we need to know also the spiritual message behind al-hajj, to know also the historical background behind al-hajj. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He ordains al-hajj, He wants to link us with the previous generations who came before us, with the righteous ancestors, with our righteous predecessors, from Abraham, peace be upon him, to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Because al-hajj is full of historical lessons. For example, when we look at al-Kaaba, when we circle al-Kaaba, when we circumambulate al-Kaaba, we should remember the Prophet Abraham and his son Ismail, Ishmael, peace be upon them both, when they would construct al-Kaaba, the building of al-Kaaba, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed both of them to build al-Kaaba. They would do so, they would build al-Kaaba, but beside them being prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would supplicate to the Almighty that He accepts their deeds. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. They would say, while they're constructing al-Kaaba, they are doing this form of worship, this great form of worship, constructing and building al-Kaaba, and they are prophets and messengers of Allah, but this fact doesn't prevent them from praying to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this righteous deed. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. O our Lord, accept from us. You are the all-hearing, the all-knowing. And this is a great lesson for us when we perform the prayer, for example, when we fast the month of Ramadan, when we perform al-hajj, we should also ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us. This, even if we perform the prayer, the fasting, the pilgrimage, according to our knowledge perfectly and correctly, we still have to pray to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our righteous deeds, because we might commit something unknowingly. We might commit a mistake or shortcoming or shortfall over the course of performing that form of worship unknowingly, unintentionally. So we need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive that shortcoming. So here a great lesson in al-hajj. For example, when we go beyond the two hills of As-Safa and Al-Marwa, we need to remember Hagar alayhi salam, may Allah have mercy on her, the mother of Ismail, and that great incident when Abraham, peace be upon him, left both Hagar and her infant Ismail alayhi salam, may Allah have mercy on them both, when he left them in that barren valley, that valley that has nothing, that has nothing of the essentials of life. He left them there, and we should remember when Hagar asked Abraham, saying, is it Allah who commanded you to leave us here in this barren valley, in this valley? When Abraham said to her, yes, it is Allah who commanded me, she said to him, she replied back to him, then go, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forsake us. If it is a commandment, if it is a revelation from Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then go, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forsake us. He will take care of us. He will surely take care of us. So we should remember, as we do as-sa'i bayna as-safa wal-marwa, as-sa'i literally means exerting efforts, walking between As-Safa and Marwa, we should remember Hagar alayhi salam when they were short of water, and Ismail, her infant, was starving out of thirst. He wants to drink water, and they didn't have water. She started, Hagar, peace be upon her, she starting running, walking and running in the valley between As-Safa and Marwa. And she would climb As-Safa and would go to Al-Marwa and climb again to Al-Marwa and look around if there is anybody, if there is any source of water. And she would do that between As-Safa and Al-Marwa until she did that 7 times. There Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them by Zamzam water, the water of Zamzam, which is a source of life from that time on till the day of resurrection, insha'Allah ta'ala, if Allah wills. The Zamzam water is one of the miracles from the time of Ismail and Ibrahim, peace be upon them. We should remember Hagar's effort. We should remember also, while drinking Zamzam water, that this is a blessing from Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Zamzam water has been feeding, giving water to millions and millions every year. Perhaps millions every day, not even every year. But this Zamzam water is still giving people. And the more you take water from it, the more water comes from under ground. There are experiments done to Zamzam water, giving or revealing the unique features of Zamzam water. From that features is whatever you take from Zamzam water, the groundwater comes again to replace what is taken off water. As I said, millions of people drink from Zamzam water every day in Al-Haram. And beside the fact that some of the waters are taken for Al-Madinah Haram, some of the waters are taken by pilgrims back home. So it is really a blessed water. Even the components of Zamzam water is different to the components of the ordinary waters, according to some experiments done to this water. So one should remember as well this incident of Hagar and Ismail and Abraham peace be upon them all. How one should be submitting, how one should submit his will to the will of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abraham, although he has that feeling and emotion of fatherhood, but he still left his wife and his infant in that barren valley because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to do so. And Hagar accepted this reality because of the simple fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them. So we should submit our will to the will of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the nature of taklif. A taklif is the responsibility. We are responsible before Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a taklif by nature involves hardship. And one should understand that and bear that in mind before he goes or she goes to Al-Hajj. He should take into account that he's going to experience some hardships, some difficulties, just like our previous ancestors and predecessors experienced hardship, including the Prophet Abraham, the Khalilullah. The Khalilullah means the intimate friend of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He himself experienced this hardship. When we slaughter the animal, when we sacrifice the animal, we should remember also Khalilullah Ibrahim, when he saw in his dream that he is slaughtering his only son Ismail alayhi salam. At that time, his only son Ismail alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him by a dream to slaughter his son. And let's see what was the response of Ismail, that young boy, when his dad told him that I see in my dream that I slaughter you. The righteous boy replies back to him, Ya abati fa'al ma tu'mar, satajiduni insha'allahu min as-sabirin. Oh my father, comply with what you are commanded to do. Abide by the divine instructions that revealed to you. You will find me among those who are patients. ستجدني إن شاء الله من الصابرين. فلما أسلم وتله للجبين. When they submitted their will to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وتله للجبين. The Gabin, this is the forehead. Otellahu, and Abraham put his son on the ground, and his forehead was on the ground. He was about to sacrifice his beloved son. There Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him. فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ وَنَادَيْنَاهُ أَيَّا إِبْرَاهِيمَ قَدْ صَدَّقْتَ الرُّؤْيَا. There we call him, O Ibrahim, you fulfilled the dream. You fulfilled the vision. وَفَدَيْنَاهُ بِذِبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced his son with ذِبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ, a great sheep, a great sacrificial animal. So we need to remember this incident when we slaughter the animal on the 10th day of Dhul Hijjah. Either we are there in the sacred lands, or we are here back home when we slaughter the animal on the 10th of the Hijjah. It is not just a tradition. It is not just a local custom, a culture. It is there to commemorate this great incident, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to remember our righteous ancestors and predecessors when they submitted their will to the will of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no matter what hardship that may incur upon us, we should submit our will to the will of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we stone the pillars there in Mina, Gamarat al-Aqaba, al-Kubra, al-Sura, al-Wusta, the major pillar of Al-Aqaba, the medium pillar, the small pillar, We should remember when Abraham, peace be upon him, casted the stones at the devil, when the devil would appear to Abraham in each place of these pillars, and Abraham would cast the stone, would stone the devil when he would appear to him. And this symbol is, this represents the fact that we are, after the day of Arafah, the following day after the day of Arafah, we are casting our sins. We are casting our shortcomings before Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is not just a physical act. We should bear in mind the spiritual lessons behind this form of worship. Because Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He instructed us to perform prayer, fasting, al-hajj, He doesn't want from us to burden ourselves, to overburden ourselves. In fact, He wants to instill a great lesson, or to instill a great quality in our heart, that is at-taqwa. At-taqwa is the ultimate purpose of all forms of worship. When we read the verses of al-Hajj, for example, the verses of al-Hajj in the second chapter, Surah al-Baqarah, the chapter of Kaf, and the chapter of pilgrimage itself, we find that almost all verses are concluded by the word of taqwa, by encouraging us, asking us to stick, to adhere to this great quality, at-taqwa, in reference to the fact that at-taqwa is the ultimate purpose of doing the rituals of al-hajj. At-taqwa has to be present in all aspects of al-hajj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He started the verse, وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ, He concluded the verse, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Then He started the following verse, Al-Hajju Ashhurun Ma'lumat, and He concluded the verse, وَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. And when He concluded this set of verses related to Al-Hajj, He says, فَمَنْ تَعَجَّلَ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ وَمَنْ تَأَخَّرَ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ لِمَنْ اتَّقَى وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. So the at-taqwa has to be present in all our rituals while performing al-hajj. And this also is applicable to all pillars of Islam, to prayer, to fasting, the month of Ramadan. As you know, the very first verse in which fasting, the month of Ramadan, was prescribed upon us, the verse was concluded by at-taqwa. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. All you who have believed, fasting has been prescribed upon you as it was prescribed upon those who came before you, so that you might attain piety, so that you might attain righteousness, so that you might attain this great quality. And when we say it is a great quality, we don't mean it is just a virtuous quality, it is just a voluntary quality. One could implement this quality or attain this quality or leave it. No, it is indispensable quality. One's iman is incomplete without having this quality. And why is that? Because it is a precondition. It is not just a virtuous quality, it is a precondition, it is a prerequisite for one's iman, for one's worship to be accepted by Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not a secret for the one who recites the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the chapter of Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إنما يتقبل الله من المتقين. Allah only accepts from the righteous. Allah only accepts from the righteous. So if you wanna your deeds be accepted by Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to be righteous. You have to have this quality, righteousness, piety. So this means piety and righteousness is a precondition for every single deed to be accepted by Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why attaining paradise or entering paradise is only and only for the righteous people. For the righteous people. تلك الدار الآخرة نجعلها للذين لا يريدون علوا في الأرض ولا فسادا والعاقبة للمتقين. And the return to paradise is only and only for the righteous people. For the righteous people. So this, I mean, this quality has to be present there while performing al-hajj, which entails that one perform al-hajj perfectly and correctly and with a sound knowledge. With a sound knowledge. So these some of the historical lessons behind al-hajj, and there is much more. And there is also a spiritual message in the aspects of al-hajj, in every single step, in almost every single step when we perform al-hajj, there is a spiritual message. Al-hajj in its entirety is a reminder of the day of judgment. It is a reminder of the day of the judgment. For example, when we go to perform al-ihram, when we take off our ordinary clothes, this reminds us when we leave this life and when our ordinary clothes are being taken from us. When you take your ordinary clothes about to perform al-ightisal, this reminds you when your soul leaves your body and you are entering the first step of the hereafter, because death is the first step of the hereafter, as we say in Arabic, من مات فقد قامت قيامته. The one who dies, his hereafter has been established. So when one dies, his relatives, his family members, his friends, they take out his clothes, his ordinary clothes, and this is what embodied in the journey of al-hajj, when we take ourselves our clothes. Here we take ourselves our clothes, but there when we pass away, someone else will take these ordinary clothes from us. And then when we wash ourselves, this remembers or this resembles when our family members, our surrounding, our contemporary are washing us before the burial. And when we put the two sheets, the two white sheets for men, the al-izar and the rida, al-izar is the lower white sheet that covers the lower part of the body. Al-rida is the upper part of the sheet that covers the upper part of the body. This remembers, this resembles our coffin, our coffin sheets or our coffin garments. And so when these meanings should be present, it is not just empty and aimless or fruitless practices. It reminds us of these incidents. And when we pray two prayers, al-ihram prayers, two rak'ah, this reminds us of the funeral prayer, when it is being prayed over us, when our friends and family members are praying the funeral prayer over us. And then when we leave al-miqat, from which we assume ihram, heading towards Mecca, saying لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك. This reminds us of the life of al-barzakh, the life of al-barzakh, is the life between this life, the worldly life, and the resurrection. And we are as if we are in a journey towards the resurrection, saying, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. We are saying, O Lord, we respond to you, O Lord. Labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. We respond to you, O Lord. There is no partner beside you. Inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika lak. All praise and all favor belong to you, O Allah. There is no partner with you. We respond to you, O Lord. So this is a talbiyah. So when we are heading towards Mecca al-Mukarrama with these ihram garments, chanting at-talbiyah, this reminds us of the life of al-Barzakh. And as we know, in the life of al-Barzakh, there is either a punishment of the grave, or there is either the favors and the smell of paradise, like as the Prophet, peace be upon him, says, Al-Qabru imma rawdatun min riyad al-Jannah. The tomb is either part of paradise or hufratun min hufar al-Nar, or it is just a hill of the hell fire. So we ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect every single one of us from the punishment of the grave and the punishment of the hell fire. So we need to remember all these lessons. And when we are present on the plain of Arafat as well, begging Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins in that great evening, in that great afternoon and evening, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sin, to pardon our shortcoming. This resembles when we are resurrected before Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that land, the land of al-mahshar, the land of resurrection, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pardon our sins, begging the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to overlook our shortfalls and shortcoming. So when we do that in Arafah, you see people in Arafah crying and weeping. You see people remembering at that day their previous sins, and they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they beg Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive their sins. Because after that is just the result. Either you are accepted, either you are supplication is accepted or is rejected. And that's why you see people are sweating, shedding their tears in the day of Arafat. They are supplicating Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the sun set. And when the sun has set, people are marching towards Al-Muzdalifa. And this reminds us of the fact people are either accepted or rejected. Reminds us when people are taking into two paths, فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ. A group, a party, are heading to paradise, and another party, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ, may Allah forbid, are heading towards hell fire. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us paradise and to protect us from hellfire. And we ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who are being accepted, not from those who are being rejected. And that's why the Prophet, peace be upon him, consider al-hajj al-mabrur, the accepted hajj, laysa lahu jaza'un illa al-jannah, has no reward less than paradise. Wal-hajj al-mabrur laysa lahu jaza'un illa al-jannah. And the accepted hajj has no reward less than paradise. And just before that, the Prophet, peace be upon him, was narrated to have said, من حج فلم يرفث ولم يفسق رجع من ذنوبه كيوم ولدته أمه. Whoever performs حج without فسوق, without sin, and without رفث, without any immoral talks or immoral actions. رجع من ذنوبه كيوم ولدته أمه. He returns back home as pure as the day in which he was born. So he is pure of any sin, and this is the situation of those who are forgiven in the day of Arafah, the greatest day across the year. People, their sheets are being cleansed on that day. Those who are accepted, their sheets are free of any spiritual filth, if we would say. So these are some of the lessons of Al-Hajj, as we mentioned. After that, one heads towards Al-Muzdalifah, and then he heads towards Mina to stone the Gamarat, to slaughter his head, to shave his hair as well, or trim at least his hair, or shave his hair. And this reminds us or resembles when one is throwing his sin, and this is like a sign or a symbol of beginning a new life. When one shaves his head, it is as if it is a sign of throwing or abandoning the previous worldly concerns, the previous sins, and establishing a new life. So this is just a short talk about the spiritual message of Al-Hajj and the background of Al-Hajj, which we have to remember. I know, as I mentioned at the outset of this talk, there are many rules and practical rulings regarding Al-Hajj, which we wouldn't be able to cover, as I said, in such short talk. But maybe we ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us one day to talk about this in details. And for those who are going to perform Al-Hajj this year, surely there will be someone to guide them, like a religious guide or a religious supervisor there, to guide them to Al-Manasik, to the rites and rituals of Al-Hajj in these blessed and sacred lands. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of this talk to accept our deeds and to make all our deeds sincere to Him, Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to grant us wisdom, sincerity in our actions, and to accept our righteous deeds, our prayer, fasting, pilgrimage to the sacred land. إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. أحسنتم. جزاكم. I'm wondering if one has any comment, any question, any remark, or anything to share. One of the things that is special to Arafah is a dua. The Prophet, peace be upon him, was reported to have said, أفضل الدعاء دعاء يوم عرفة وأفضل ما قلته أنا والنبيون من قبلي لا إله إلا الله. The best supplication is that of Arafah. أفضل الدعاء دعاء عرفة. The best of supplication of that of Arafah. وأفضل ما قلته أنا والنبيون من قبلي لا إله إلا الله. The best thing ever I said and the previous messengers before me said, لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. So what is unique about Arafah, or one of the things that is peculiar to the day of Arafah, is that its supplication, Arafah supplication, is the best supplication. So it is more likely, most likely, for your dua to be accepted on the day of Arafah, either especially if you are in Arafah, or even if you are back home. So this is one of the privilege of the day of Arafah. There are so many privileges and virtues of the day of Arafah, of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yubahi malaikata. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if he's showing pride to his angel that he's gonna forgive the sins of these people. إن الله سبحانه وتعالى يباهي ملائكته الواقفين بعرفات ويقول لهم أشهدكم أني غفرت لهم. الله سبحانه وتعالى shows this kind of magnificence to his angels because of those who are there in عرفات seeking the forgiveness of Almighty Allah سبحانه وتعالى, and he makes سبحانه وتعالى his angels witness that he forgives the sin of those who are standing in Arafat. أشهدكم أني غفرت لهم. I make you witness, O angels, that I forgive their sins. Of these privileges of Arafah, or the day of Arafah, is that ما رؤي الشيطان, according to the narration, أغيض ولا أحقر من هذا اليوم. The shaitan was not seen more inferior than on this particular day because of the forgiveness of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of his servant's repentance, because of the fact that almost pilgrims are repenting to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regretting because of what they have done in the past. And this makes the devil, the shaitan, most inferior in this day than in any other day. So these are some of the privileges of the day of Arafah. And of the privileges is that the day of Arafah is considered the culmination of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And all these 10 days or 9 days are virtuous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sworn by these days, takes oath by these days, والفجر وليال عشر. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by the 10 nights, and the top of them is the day of Arafah. So these are some of the virtues. Even when one of the virtues is to fast the day of Arafah for those who were back home, for those who are not there in Arafah, because the one who is in Arafah doesn't fast, but those who are back home, it is highly recommended to fast the day of Arafah. The Prophet, peace be upon him, tells us that fasting the day of Arafah expiates the sin of the previous year and the current year. يكفر صيام يوم عرفة يكفر ذنوب سنتين العام الماضي السنة الماضية والسنة الباقية. The fasting the day of Arafah expiates the sin of 2 years, the preceding years and the current year. So these are some of the privileges of the day of Arafah, and as you see, many of them are not confined or unique to those who are in Arafah. Even those who are here back home, even for those who are not performing Arafah or performing Al-Hajj in that year. Allah knows best. Any further? We'll come back to you. What is the significance of night of Al-Muzdalifa? There is a significance because when you get up, first the scene, as we mentioned, the scenes of Al-Hajj resemble the scenes of the hereafter. And one of that is when you sleep, when you stay in the night of Al-Muzdalifa, and when you get up. That remembers, because you see people, all people are asleep. They are asleep on like an open area. There is no tents in Muzdalifa, there are no construction in Muzdalifa, almost there is no construction in Muzdalifa apart from the facilities like toilets, for example. So there is There are no facilities, there are no buildings. So you see all people are asleep. And just before the dawn, before the prayer, all get up. And this reminds us of the resurrection from the graves, because all people, these millions of people, you see them asleep. You see only the white sheets, and they get up when it's being called for Al-Fajr prayer. It was blown on the horn when the resurrection being established. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired one of his angels to blow on the thorn, and they are being resurrected. So when Muaddin for Al-Fajr prayer calls, you see people are getting up, praying as one. And of the significance is that you have to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after Al-Fajr prayer. فَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ عِنْدَ الْمَشْعَرِ الْحَرَامِ. This is one of the obligations of Al-Hajj, to remember Allah, to mention the name of Allah عِنْدَ الْمَشْعَرِ الْحَرَامِ. And Al-Mash'ar al-Haram is Al-Muzdalifah, the entire Muzdalifah, according to some understanding. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, وَقَفْتُهَا هُنَا وَجَمْعٌ كُلُّهَا مَوْقِفٌ. I stand and stayed here, and the entire Muzdalifah is a place of standing or staying. So, فَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ عِنْدَ الْمَشْعَرِ الْحَرَامِ. Remember the name of Allah in Muzdalifah. And that's why the one who doesn't remember Allah in Muzdalifah has to slaughter an animal, because he left one of the obligations of Al-Hajj. So this is the significance of staying and remembering Allah in Al-Mustalifah. You have a question?
What if you are not able to perform and you don't have any financial for performing? What happens if the person is a Muslim still there? The fund filler will be lacking because there is no.
Yeah.
And secondly, if there's a loan in the bank, fasting is there for 10 days or only for the.
Yeah. Each single one of your questions needs to be elaborated. I mean, needs elaboration. Our sister is asking two questions. One of them is about the one who is unable to perform al-hajj, because we mentioned al-hajj is obligatory for those who are able. So if one is unable to perform al-hajj, is he still a truthful and faithful Muslim? The answer to that, if he is really unable to perform al-hajj, incapable to perform al-hajj, he doesn't possess the financial capability, the physical capability, then he is exempted from performing al-hajj. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala overlooks, because there is a rule, a juristic rule, which state, إِذَا أَخَدَ اللَّهُ مَا وَهَبْ أَسْقَطَ مَا أَوْجَبْ. If Allah takes what he grants, for example, the physical strength and the financial ability, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala drops what he obligates. So in this case, yes, if she is or he is unable to perform al-hajj physically and financially, he is exempted and excused. But there is a question. If one is unable, he isn't fit enough to perform al-hajj physically, he doesn't have the bodily strength to perform al-hajj himself or herself, but he has the financial capability, the financial means to hire someone, to depute someone to perform al-hajj on his behalf, is al-hajj obligatory upon him? Yes, in this case, according to the most reliable viewpoint of the scholars, al-hajj is obligatory upon him if he is able to hire someone else, if he is able to depute someone, even without paying him any wage. For example, if a woman is unable to perform, but she has a daughter, she has a son who have performed al-hajj in the past, and who is willing or able to perform al-hajj on his mom's behalf or his dad's behalf, then he has to debut someone to perform al-hajj on his or on her behalf.